bowerhawk migrate the southern United States.
The sea washes it away, leaving only the warm skin.
Long before us humans figured out how to make 18-hour direct flights between New York and Singapore, and before we invented the compass, learned how to use the stars to navigate, and long before we figured out that the Earth wasn't flat, animals were one step ahead. Why? To migrate. Hi, I'm Aranya Iyer, and you're watching Animalogic Second Nature. Migration is seen in a huge range of animals.
From the icy waters of the Arctic, they come each fall. They provide one of nature's great spectacles, the annual migration of the California gray whale, the longest known migration of any mammal.
From mammals to crustaceans to fish, reptiles, amphibians, and insects, almost every type of animal has figured it out. What sets migration apart from regular old movement is that for vertebrates, the seasonal behavior includes a return trip. No one-way tickets allowed here. Animals use three main types of internal compasses to find their way during migration.
There are several ways to orient a map, but one of the fastest and most accurate is with a compass.
First, there is a magnetic compass, which is sensitive to the Earth's magnetic field. The second is a sun compass, which combines the perception of the sun and time of day to show the way. The third is a star compass, a literal star map, which nocturnally migrating animals use to orient themselves. Though we're not exactly sure how migratory behaviors evolved separately in so many unrelated species, looking at the drive behind migrations provides some insight. One of the major reasons that animals migrate is to seek out better weather conditions. Those that moved away from deadly situations, like a lack of food or inclement weather, were more likely to survive.
The theory then goes that natural selection played a role in the evolution of migration. Those that successfully migrated made it, and those who didn't. No one searches longer and further for good weather than the Arctic tern. When you hear the word migration, your mind probably first lands on birds.
That's because about 4,000 species, or 40% of the world's birds, migrate every year.
Turkey vultures move southward in winter. The rough-legged hawk migrates northward to nest in Canada. The sparrowhawk migrates to southern United States and as far south as Central America.
The petite Arctic tern takes the prize, though, for the planet's longest migration.
As their name suggests, Arctic terns hatch in the summer at the northernmost edge of the Arctic Circle, way up here. When it starts to get too cold or too dark for the colony to hunt during the sunless Arctic winters, they make their way down south to follow the light. They do not want to end up in a 30 days of night situation. They are constantly headed towards the hemisphere of the globe that is tilted towards the sun, ensuring that no matter where they are, it's always summer.
Every year comes the summer, and with the summer, the heat. No such thing as a heat wave by the sea, the beautiful sea.
Likely guided by their geomagnetic compass, this journey takes them all the way to the Antarctic Circle before they return again to their northern homelands.
No one ever taught these birds the way home. No one ever showed them the path they should take.
And Arctic terns don't make pit stops on this gargantuan 96,000 kilometer odyssey. They do everything on the wing, including sleeping and eating. Given that Arctic terns can live up to 30 years, some individuals will migrate literally millions of kilometers in their lifetime. Talk about raking in those air miles. Similarly, indigo buntings migrate from North to South America in the fall. They're a night migrating species, so they use the stars to find their way to their winter homes in the tropics. Another extreme lightweight that is known to follow good weather conditions is the endangered monarch butterfly. Weighing less than half a gram, their migrations span not only countries, but also generations.
This indescribably beautiful creation was but a few days ago a lowly crawling caterpillar. But now, its recreated body is pumping fluid into the veins of wings destined for the glorious freedom of the boundless skies.
It takes four generations of monarch butterflies to complete one round trip between southern Canada and the mountain forests of Mexico. The generation that flies south travels the furthest. How each generation knows which direction to go when they emerge from their chrysalises is akin to how humans navigate. They use their sun compasses and internal clocks. This means they use the position of the sun and the time of day to tell them which direction to go.
At last, it tries its wings and rises with majestic power to frolic in the sunny meadows.
Some populations of beluga, found throughout the Arctic and subarctic waters, similarly migrate seasonally to avoid becoming frozen whalesicles.
The belugas can tolerate water up to the freezing point and lack a dorsal fin, which allows them to swim easily under ice floes. There is still the danger of being trapped by the rapidly freezing water.
As the ice in the Arctic begins to form in autumn, the belugas head south for the winter.
Belugas are social animals, living in pods with babies staying with their mothers for 2 to 3 years. Scientists believe that their migrations are cultural, with roots being learned and passed on from generation to generation.
Some migrations last months. Others last just a day. The golden jellyfish of Palau's Jellyfish Lake migrate every single day to find their light.
As soon as the morning sun peaks over the horizon, the golden jellyfish swim over to the east end of the lake to meet it. Throughout the day, they follow the arc of the sun all the way over to the west end, where they'll spend the night. The break of dawn starts this mini-migration all over again.
This extreme sun-seeking is key to the golden jellyfish's survival. Golden jellyfish have a mutualistic relationship with tiny photosynthetic organisms that live within them. They're called zooxanthellae, and they provide the jellyfish with energy through photosynthesis. So, the jellies must ensure that the zooxanthellae are always in the sunlight. They even avoid shadows cast by the lake's surrounding trees to ensure that their zooxanthellae besties get as much sunlight as possible.
Large numbers of animals survive only because their range is vast. If the great herds of caribou were to linger, they would quickly destroy their source of food.
Migration is all about this, finding the best conditions possible. And caribou roam up to 4,400 kilometers a year to give birth far from predators, look for the tastiest snacks, and even avoid pesky mosquitoes.
All pregnant females give birth within 1 week or so of each other. To give birth, caribou travel north together to areas with fewer predators like wolves, black bears, golden eagles, and coyotes. The theory is that this massive synchronous birth event overwhelms the limited number of predators in the area, ensuring that as many calves as possible survive. As the colder weather approaches in the fall, they head back further south.
When not looking for the best possible weather conditions, animals will travel long distances for life's greatest motivator, food. It is astonishing how far animals will travel for a good snack.
These sounds are the songs of the humpbacks.
After wintering and breeding in the tropical and subtropical waters, humpback whales use their magnetic compasses to migrate north almost 5,000 kilometers to the zooplankton-rich waters of higher latitudes.
This takes them about 4 to 8 weeks.
It's here that they'll eat massive amounts of krill and small fish, which they strain through their baleen plates in their mouths like a sieve. They need the spring, summer, and fall to bulk up for the journey back down south. Since they don't eat at all while migrating or breeding, they live entirely off of their fat reserves until they return to their northern feeding grounds the following spring.
Wildebeests, which are native to the Serengeti Plains of Africa, are in a constant state of migration. They move in an enormous loop through Kenya and Tanzania, chasing the rains that bring delicious vegetation.
Run! Run at all costs! But as you don't know where to run, you just run in circles.
When you have over 1.5 million mouths to feed, you need to constantly be on the move to find new sources of food.
However, the wildebeest's path takes them straight through many croc-riddled rivers. This means that predators of the wildebeests, like the giant Nile crocodiles, are also well-fed by this migration.
The third and final reason animals migrate is for reproduction and all that goes along with it, from finding the perfect mate to birthing the next generation.
The eels, mysterious creatures that swim thousands of miles each year to lay their eggs in the Sargasso Sea. The amphibians, these and their kindred, are time land dwellers that return water each spring to breed.
Millions of red crabs begin their march for multiplication. When the first droplets of rain fall on Christmas Island, they swarm out of their forest homes and into the ocean to breed. But their migration needs to be perfectly timed.
In the last quarter of the moon, as the tide wanes, they spawn before dawn.
Nope, this isn't a Wiccan chant. It's the only time a Christmas Island red crab will reproduce.
Depending on when the first rain falls, the crabs either hurry up or take it slow to make this very important date with destiny.
Going in the opposite direction, from ocean inland, salmon also migrate for reproductive purposes.
In May, millions of full-grown salmon school together in the North Pacific to begin their great migration, known to Alaskans as the Salmon Run.
The salmon swim upstream against the current to freshwater rivers and creeks to spawn.
Once they reproduce, the salmon die, leaving it up to the next generation to start the next leg of migration. The hatchlings will spend their youthful days in those shallow waters before making their way down the river and back out to the ocean.
Last but not least, let's touch on a few animals that get honorable migration mentions. While not migrators in the traditional sense of the word, these animals are on the move.
The army ant, for example, is famous for its lack of a fixed address. Army ant colonies cycle between two phases: stationary, in which the queen is busy laying eggs, and nomadic, in which the colony is roving, looking for prey to supply the queen's hungry larvae.
Now the queen does nothing but lay eggs. Those small gelatinous-looking things, they're the workers, appear to take care of the newborn larva right away. They clean it and carry it off to the, you might call it the playroom.
Then there's a saltwater crocodile. Found in the shallow coastal waters between northern Australia and East India, these giants are extremely territorial.
When one of the 1% that survive to adulthood grows up and needs a permanent home, they often travel far and wide, roaming up to 900 kilometers over the open ocean in search of the perfect home.
We can't forget to mention the Mongolian gray wolf, which wins the prize for the furthest distance traveled by a land animal in a year. Males of the species have been recorded running over 7,000 kilometers per year. That's like running from New York to Machu Picchu, all in search of the Asiatic Wild Ass. The name of the Asiatic Wild Ass isn't even the coolest thing about these nomadic donkey cousins. They are the most mobile ungulates on Earth, traveling further than caribou and wildebeest in a single year.
While their random movements don't technically qualify as migration, as they don't have a specific destination, they are constantly in search of better weather, food, and water in their ever-changing Mongolian desert homeland.
The need to find resources in the harsh and unpredictable conditions of the Mongolian desert is actually why its people adopted a nomadic lifestyle. So, like other animals, even we humans have adopted a life on the move.
The distance we drive our cars and trucks every day would take us on 5 daily round trips to the sun, to our ever-widening horizons of tomorrow.
So what should we talk about next? Let me know in the comments down below, and don't forget to hit subscribe for new episodes every week. Thanks for watching, and keep moving to new places. I'll see you later. That's like traveling between New York and Machu Picchu in search of that ass.